any place we could play. Beer joints, churches, theaters, any places we could play.
He said, well, I'm Hank Williams, follow me. We went out the door and around the corner to a hawk shop. And he said, Jake, have you got any more of them blackjacks back there? And he said, yeah. He said, give me five of them. And he passed them out and he said, boys, if y'all gonna play with me, by God, you gonna need these. And we did.
Hank says, well, the girls liked the band members, but the country boys didn't like the band members taking their girls and when they end up in a fight. And Hank would usually end up using his guitar as a weapon and crack it over somebody's head. And so he bought a guitar about once a week, the cheap kind.
He'd keep his guitar case, he carried a gun with him all the time. And he'd keep that guitar case open, right by the side of where he could get it. And he'd have the lid up where they couldn't see it, you know.
Wherever he played, Aunt Lily was there. She was his manager, his mother, and pushing his career. She was no nonsense. Aunt Lily was a hard working woman, and she was a hard woman.
Boy, she'd take her fist and knock a man down in a minute. I've seen her do it. She was something else now. But she thought a heap of Hank. She really thought a heap of Hank.
You know, there's not many people that doesn't drink.
Mm-hmm.
And we were going down to Georgiana to play. And some of the boys had something to drink, and they kept asking him to drink. And he would never drink when I was along.
When you were along, he wouldn't
That's
drink.
That's right. Mm-hmm. And he says, Mother, I think I'll take a drink. I says, no, you wait till the show's over and then get you a bottle and carry it home with you. He says, oh, I'm not going home anymore. If I can't have it now, I'm not going home anymore.
Hank was a binge drinker. And of course, it's the binges that people remember. And he was a binge drinker with a dreadfully low tolerance for alcohol, so it didn't take much to put him under the table. And Lily's response to this was to cuss him out, like she cussed Lon out. And when it got so bad that she couldn't handle it anymore, she had him committed to a sanitarium.
I told him one time, I said, before I left the band, I said, Hank, if you don't straighten up, quit drinking, get yourself straightened out. I said, you'll never amount to a damn thing. So he became the world's greatest songwriter, and I went into the service.
Now I got rock and gym money, but I got it the hard, hard way. I fought in every battle from the start to the VJ day.
The Warriors were a tough time for Hank. He couldn't go off and fight like other kids because he was 4F. He tried working in the shipyards in Mobile, but only lasted a few weeks at a time. At the same time, he couldn't keep on playing much either because the draft had depleted the little pool of musicians that he drew on in and around Montgomery. So he just ended up taking whatever music jobs he could.
Comb your hair. You act proud and I'll act prouder. You sing loud and I'll sing louder. Tonight we're setting the woods on fire.
I met Hank on a medicine show. I had never seen a medicine show, didn't know anything about a medicine show until I met him.
We sell you one bottle of oil for 50 cents or three bottles for a dollar. Now I am all through talking. If you care to be waited upon the rattlesnake oil, I will be glad to supply you.
At intermission, the performers would go around and sell all these herbs, you know. When Hank came by my car and he said, ma'am, don't you think you need some of these herbs? And I'll never forget this. He looked and then he took a quick back look, you know. And he said, no, ma'am, I don't believe you do. And that's what started the whole thing. And that following night, he asked me to marry him. And I said, this man's crazy. This boy's crazy. And I told my aunt, I said, he's crazy.
She is from a little town called Banks, Alabama. And when you're from Banks, Alabama, you're gonna do everything you can to get out of Pike County.
What's the title of this, nun?
I'm telling you.
Telling what you're telling me?
I'm only kidding, Hank.
You're only kidding? All right, here we go then.
he'd let her sing. She wanted to, and he'd let her do it. And we all know that Audrey was not a great singer. And Hank said, he came off stage one day and said, "Boy, it's rough to have a wife that wants to sing." He said, "It's hell to have one that wants to sing and can't."
She wanted to be part of the career, you know, so she, a lot of times, that's what they'd get in argument about is, you know, he'd write a song and he'd get up there and sing it on the radio, and she'd tell him he wasn't singing it right, or he missed something in it, you know. And now that had upset him. He said, I wrote that song, said, I know how it's supposed to go, you know, and then that had caused a big argument. And she never would back down. They'd get in a big row over it, you know.
Now you'd better straighten out, I'm telling you.
Thank you, ma'am. I don't know whether you're kidding or not after listening to the words to that.
She was all the time up there, going from door to door, trying to get that boy started. And I hang on her a lot of that. Sure did. If it hadn't been her, he might not have never made it. I'll be fair with you. Because you got to have somebody to push you, no matter how good you are.
Main thing Hank wanted to do was be a songwriter. He wanted to be a successful songwriter. That's what his ambition was. That's the reason he started bringing his songs to Fred Rose, who was in the music publishing business.
Hank had written a few songs, and I thought they were good. I had an appointment with Fred Rose. And Hank and I came from Montgomery on the train up to Nashville. And I made the call. Well, the nearer the time came, the nearer Hank backed out of going. And I said, "You're going if I have to push you. Every step of the way, there you're going."
Rose signed Hank, and he signed him to write gospel songs. And Hank was pretty good at it. And after just a few months, he got him a deal with a small record label out in New York. That was Hank's foot in the door.
Came in last night at 10:30. That baby of mine wouldn't let me in, so move it on over.
I asked him one time, I said, "Where do you get all your ideas for your songs?" He said, "Well, I don't think nobody knows this but you, but," he says, "I get my ideas from songs from these right here." And he had a stack of funny books, you know, little 10-cent funny books they used to have.
I said, "Hank, why are you reading those sissy magazines?" He said, "Sissy?" I said, "My sister read those books." And he said, "Sissy, hell boy, where do you think I get my ideas for songs?"
House it all so easy, on over. Drag it on over,
move it on over,
move over, old dog, cause a new dog's moving in.
Hank knew that if he was to capitalize in any way on the success of moving on over, that he had to get out of Montgomery. The Opry would have been Hank's first choice, but the buzz around him was already sufficiently bad, so he was going to have to go to a smaller jamboree on a smaller station, and that station was KWKH in Shreveport.
She told me not to play around, but I done let the deal go down, so pack it.
KWKH covered 20 states at night. And of course, it was picked up by CBS later on, picked up by Armed Forces Radio, so it was a worldwide thing. They were being heard by the world, as a matter of fact. His reputation had preceded him as being probably a problem child, and we knew that. And took him anyway.
Aunt Lily had a mixed emotions about Hank leaving Montgomery. She felt that he could stay here and eventually make Grand Ole Opry. But Audrey knew better, and it turned out that Audrey was right. Hank would have never gone as far as he did if he had stayed in Montgomery, I don't think.
She was already married when she met Hank, and she had a 2-year-old daughter named Lucretia.
Mother and Lily, I think they wanted the same thing, but they both wanted to be in control of what was going on, and that's just not possible. I don't feel like that if Daddy had stayed in Montgomery with Lily that he would have gotten as far as he did, because I don't think that she would have ever taken enough interest to push him out of Montgomery.
They were both pushing him a little bit, sometimes in opposite directions. And that's kind of when it started to take its toll on Hank.
The Louisiana Hay Ride, tonight from Shreveport, Louisiana, brought to you by Jack's Beer and starring Hank Williams, Johnny and Jack, Miss Kitty Wells, and a host of entertainers. Stand by for the Hay Ride on KWKH.
I got a feeling called the blues. Oh, Lord, since my baby said goodbye. Lord, I don't know what I'll do. All I do is sit and sigh. Oh, Lord, that last long day she said goodbye. Well, Lord, I thought I would cry. She'll do me, she'll do you. She's got that kind of love.
But the yodel, when he hit that yodel, that's when they came out of those chairs. They threw babies in there.
I hate to think it all over. I've lost my heart, it seems.
Hank made it with that lovesick blues. That's what made him. That song broke all barriers, if he was any. It broke
them. Them women lay down and faint. I've seen them fall out and faint right down the floor just watching him sing that song.
And when he would hunch over the microphone and look into your eyes, he got through to the audience. I mean, they were spellbound.
Love is a beautiful gal, but she don't care about me. Lord, I tried and I tried to keep her satisfied, but she just wouldn't stay.
So now... Folks, in case you didn't know it, Audrey is my wife. And with Audrey, I'd like for you to come up and tell the folks about Randall.
You mean Hank Jr.?
Yeah.
So I like to put myself in that perspective of that time and try to go back and just realize where they came from and how rough it was and how poor it was.
He'd tell everybody about him expecting that baby, yeah, on the stage and everything.
Well, folks, he's a little over a year and a half old, and I think that he's just about the most wonderful thing that ever happened.
Sure you do, and so do I. And folks, I guess there wasn't ever a parent born who didn't feel the same way about their child.
In a lot of ways, the year that Hank spent in Shreveport was the happiest of his life. Audrey was away from Lily, which improved her disposition no end. He could feel the momentum of his career building. Lucretia was with them. Audrey got pregnant. And Hank was sober. He was sober for most of the year that he was there.
All I do is sit and sigh. Oh, Lord, that last long day she said goodbye. Well, Lord, I thought I would cry. She'll do me, she'll do you. She's got that kind of loving. Lord, I love to hear her when she calls me sweet. Daddy's a
So I think with the intervention of Acuff Rose, Fred Rose, they promised that if Hank Williams could be sober for a year on the Louisiana Hay Ride in Shreveport, that possibly the Grand Ole Opry would accept him.
I'm a rolling stone, all alone and lost. Life of sin, I have paid the cost. When I pass by, all the people say, just another guy on the lost highway.
This is the place, the Grand Ole Opry House in Nashville, Tennessee, the home of the country music show of shows, the Grand Ole Opry.
He was there with the greatest country music singers in the world. I mean, you got Red Foley, you had Roy Acuff, you had Hank Snow, you had Jimmy Dick, all these guys who had done all these great things. And here comes this little guy from Alabama, and you say, well, you know, we didn't expect too much.